And you know what time it is? It's time for KP's video news. KP's video news, y'all.
That's right, it's time for KP's video news, y'all. And it's time for you, everybody, to get up and do what you gotta do. Gotta get out there and vote. I went and dropped mine off directly at the my local election office and put it right in the drop box right at the election office. I mean, it only takes a minute. Just go ahead and do what you got to do. I'm quite sure you got your ballots. Fill them out. All your places that got early voting, you can drop them off. Do what you got to do. Handle your business. You know, handle your business. You know, on November 4th, don't complain. Here we go, a serious story here. We have Attorney Ben Crump calls for a comprehensive investigation after Florida police rule Nevin Baker's hanging death as suicide. Now, this is about the fifth hanging of a black person that this year, and every single time that a black person has been hung in the last 5 months, every time the police say the same thing. It's a suicide. Since when do black people hang themselves from trees? Since when does suicide by hanging, since when is that something that black people do? Knowing that our history with lynching, knowing what's going on with that. And coincidentally, it's like every time this happens, the police are the ones that find them. It's mighty suspicious if you ask me. So, you know, anyway, civil rights attorney Ben Crump is calling for an investigation after Florida police ruled the death of Nevin Baker, the black man found hanging from a tree as suicide. The family of the man also wants more information. And though the police department has said it has exhausted all leads in the case and found no evidence of foul play, Nevin Baker, 22 years old, was found just after 3:30 a.m. on October 5th. Police were called to a park by a person who reported seeing a man hanging from a tree, according to a case report from the Orlando Police Department. Three officers at the scene tried to help Baker. According to a report, one officer grabbed Baker by the lower half while the other two cut a white rope in order to get Baker on the ground. Officers were not able to find a pulse once he was on the ground, police stated in the report. And so while police and the medical examiner's office have ruled Baker's death a suicide, Crump on Sunday tweeted that Baker's hands were tied, teeth were missing, and his face was bruised. With the hashtag Justice for Nevin, Crump added, "We demand transparency in the comprehensive investigation so we can exactly know what happened." Sharonda James, Baker's mom, stated she noticed injuries to Baker's nose, forehead, and jaw when she saw him in the morgue. She told a newspaper she has no reason to believe her son killed himself. "We're not going to let this go. The community is not going to let this go," James stated. And the Orlando Police Department released a statement Friday calling Baker's death a suicide. "We have seen on social posts regarding a man who was found deceased in Barker Park. This is a tragic case of suicide, and it's difficult for investigators to discuss details publicly." It's difficult for investigators to discuss details publicly out of respect to the victim's privacy and of that of the family. So, I mean, it's one of those crazy situations. The county medical examiner's office also ruled a man to be death by suicide in the case of synopsis. And the medical examiner's office did not immediately respond to a request for the full autopsy report. So I'm telling you, man, this whole thing is it smells. Thing stinks. I'm telling you, it stinks. And and the medical examiner's office did not immediately respond to a request for the full autopsy report. Officer of fact has exhausted all leads, and at this time, there is no evidence of foul play or any kind of physical struggle, or at least said but the medical examiner also investigated and ruled that our detectives continue to support the victim's family where they can. We are keeping the victim, his family, and friends in our thoughts during this difficult time. A case similar to that found by another black man hanging from a tree in Robert Fuller's death in Palmdale, California, led to the outcry for police investigating after the 24-year-old death was ruled a suicide. Authorities again ruled a death a suicide after investigation. A second California man, a 38-year-old Malcolm Hirsch, was also found hanging over the summer, which saw hate crimes and violence against black Americans amid protests of racial justice. He's dead, died in Victorville, and it was stated as a suicide. And then there was also a third man in Las Vegas who was hanging on a fence in Las Vegas, and they ruled that a suicide. And there was a couple of others in Georgia that were ruled a suicide. So this is sorry policing is at the point where you figure they don't give a damn how these people died, and they're just labeling it a suicide to keep from having to investigate it. Or, hey, maybe they might be guilty of it. So, Black Lives Matter launches a political action committee. On the heels of nearly 6 months of nationwide demonstrations that sparked an international movement against systematic racism and police violence, Black Lives Matter is expanding its influence into politics, forming a political action committee, a highly unusual move for a grassroots organization with no central leadership. Black Lives Matter PAC will formally roll out its program as early as Monday, according to Patrice Cullors, a co-founder of Black Lives Matter. The committee plans to endorse a slate of candidates ahead of the general election, paying special attention to mayoral, county sheriff, and district attorney races. We want to be able to not just speak in the get out and vote language, Cullors said in an interview, but Black Lives Matter is launching our PAC so we can talk directly to voters about who we think they should be voting for and what we think they should be voting on. PAC formation is the latest in the rare political efforts from social organizations ahead of November election. In late September, the Movement for Black Lives, a coalition of more than 50 organizing groups nationwide, launched the frontline initiative to turn out the vote among young people of color. Black Lives Matter also has spearheaded four projects aiming to encourage young black voters to head to the polls, including a multi-million dollar outreach campaign and an anti-disinformation initiative. Get out there and vote. Get out there and vote, people. Vote. Play your part. You got to get out there and vote. Movement leaders too are laying the groundwork for a national policy overhaul that means the demands for change born out of the summer of protests. On Thursday, the Working Families Party announced its 2021 legislative proposal in partnership with Black Lives Matter leaders and progressive organizing groups. The platform has the support of several progressive lawmakers, including Representatives Rashida Tlaib, Ayanna Pressley, Ilhan Omar, and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Cullors said the Black Lives Matter Political Action Committee gives the movement an opportunity to hold elected officials accountable on their turf. The group will continue to push for policy changes, Cullors said, and now with the PAC, the organization can wield greater influence from the inside, says she says Stacey Abrams of 2018 Georgia gubernatorial loss is one example of why movement work is an important component to electoral politics. The goal of the PAC is to put more candidates who align with Black Lives Matter goals in office. And along those lines, you have Black Lives Matter ignites activism among Asian Americans. And Peter Zhang, watched the footage showing the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis nearly a dozen times. He saw a video of a confrontation between a white woman and a black bird watcher in New York City. This is when it all clicked for him. For years, the Great Neck, New York resident had been aware of the Black Lives Matter movement, but Zhang didn't pay much attention to it until he saw the videos in May of a white police officer pinning his knee on Floyd's neck and a woman calling the police on a black man after he asked her to leash her dog in Manhattan Central Park. And in the video, you could hear the woman could be heard telling the 911 operator that she was threatened by an African-American man. And he said it kind of changed his views. In the past few months since the movement heated up, Zhang, who's 61 years old, who immigrated from China to the United States decades ago, I think I need to raise my voice so that everybody can hear. We are part of it. We are not absent. The realization pushed Zhang, one of more than 200,000 Asians living on Long Island, to join a June protest in the Great Neck where hundreds marched. Nationwide, Zhang appears to be one of the growing number of Asian Americans who attributes over the summer shifted in support of Black Lives Matter movement. Through that support may be slipping, as Pew Research reporters last week, the public support for the movement has decreased from June to September. But earlier in July, 3 out of 4 Asians surveyed in Gallup poll stated that they changed their views on racial justice because of the protests. And demonstrations had ebbed on Long Island before, but were reignited this week after the Kentucky grand jury's decision not to indict any officer in the death of Breonna Taylor, a black woman who was shot in a raid by Louisville police in March. And that change of heart is not a surprise, said Frank Wu, president of Queens College and the author Yellow Race in America Beyond Black and White. Asian Americans in general have been trending more liberal for about a generation, Wu said. Many Asian Americans see a parallel between the hatred they are feeling, even when they are walking down the street because of COVID-19, and what African Americans are talking about, referring to the backlash Asians in the United States have faced because of the coronavirus, which was been termed the Chinese virus by Donald Trump. Discussions on race, which traditionally have been framed as a black-white issue, left many Asians wondering where they fit in, Wu said. Are they honorary whites? Are they people of color? Wu said, who is of Chinese descent. Asian Americans are both ambiguous and ambivalent. Some Asian Americans don't know how they feel, and that's all starting to change. And so people are waking up. They're waking up and they're realizing, well, hey, we all have the same struggles here. Whether you black, Hispanic, Asian, you know, you come from South America, Africa, you know, wherever you come from, you know, if you put in a lump in the category of a minority, you're going to be all treated the same. So a father breaks up a street fight, and you have Ibn Ali found himself at the corner of attention after stopping a street fight between two young men, Sheldon Ward and Jamar Mobley, in his hometown of Atlantic City, New Jersey. The video of his street intervention went viral on social media after it was posted on Facebook. Miller said he didn't want the praise for his actions and just considered it something anybody should do and would do. He said, I'm a Muslim and I was raised by Muslim parents. That's what we were taught in my house always growing up. Don't look at it like I'm a peacemaker. I did what I was supposed to do, what I was raised to do. In the viral video, the New Jersey man first steps to the group aggressively, calling the crowd that gathered to record the fight real cowards. It's not cool, man. Y'all in the middle of the street, he tells the young men before pointing out that their friends are watching them and laughing, and they stop to listen to him. Miller then tells the young generation present that they are old enough to take responsibility for their actions. Man, you guys are almost men. You're not kids anymore. You girls aren't little girls anymore. You're men. Start acting like it. You all got parents And don't make them look like fools out here. This is important. He also calls out high school kids he recognized from the neighborhood, telling one, "I know where you from, humble beginnings. Your mom and dad worked hard to get where you at." He said, telling another one, "Your dad," he told another one, "your dad is doing a life sentence. And you think this is a game?" Miller finally gets the team combatants to shake hands, make peace, and walk away from the scuffle. Although the boys shake hands and realize that they learned a valuable lesson, Miller goes on to mention that he doesn't want recognition for what he did, even though, you know, it's like, you know, he did stop these young black men from fighting each other. And, you know, that's what you're supposed to do, man. Say, "I just didn't want those kids to fight. More importantly, I did not want those kids to lose the fight," he told. He stated, "Sometimes when you're young like that and you lose a fight in front of your friends that goes on Facebook, it could hurt you for a long time," he added. "The video of a street fight is always bound to go viral, but it matters more what Miller valued in teaching the young man. It's clear that it isn't the first fight he's seen in the community, and we applaud how he wanted to make a difference." That's right, brother. Thank you for standing up. Thank you for doing that. And hey, we need more people to intervene and step in and do what you got to do, because you know, it's just a sad situation, a sad day we living in today, that these things happen. They happen all the time, and I don't know. I really don't know sometimes, you know. I try my best to understand some things, but it's just some things just don't have no real true value or real true meaning anymore these days. So you gotta evaluate things on a day by day basis. All right, folks, that's KP's Video News. Get out there and vote. Go vote. Peace.